morning. My name is Suvin Kim. I'm Artistic Director of Chamber Music Northwest. Welcome to everybody to this masterclass by cellist Zlatomir Fung and the students of our Young Artists Institute. These are 15 wonderful string players from around the world, all who are in high school or just graduated from high school. And we have four wonderful cellists who are going to be playing for Zlatomir this morning. Zlatomir, if I dared to start reciting his competition prizes and awards, we'd be here all day. He's just seemingly won everything in the world, but most recently the Tchaikovsky competition in Moscow, and he has gone on to have one of the most flourishing performing careers, both as a soloist and as a chamber musician, including here at Chamber Music Northwest. So please welcome Zlatomir Fung.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, so thank you, Suvin. So to begin, we have four wonderful cellists who will be playing. And the first who will be playing is Hira Wang, and she will be playing the third movement of the Prokofiev Cello Sonata.
Thank you.
Two relationships you can have with a piece. One is where it's dominating you, and the other is where you're dominating it. And you generally want to be in the latter. And it feels like you're in the latter, yeah. Dominating, of course, is a strong word, but you know, sometimes it really does feel like you're not the one in control. That's not a great feeling. So, I think the only general comment I would have for the performance as a whole is that I think this piece is very interesting for several reasons, but one of which is that the first movement is very expansive, you know, for a first movement. It's even though it's not slow, it feels slow. And moreover, the types of sonorities that Prokofiev creates are very sustained on the whole. You know, you have those long notes on the C string, and all the melodies are very kind of like rich, and there's a lot of syrupy quality in the sound, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that as the piece goes on, the second movement, with the exception of the middle of the second movement, but you know, this movement also, it becomes more about the individual notes' initial stages. You know, it's a bad way of phrasing it, but basically that's to say that I think if you think actually as the cellist a little more vertically about each note, then you can create textures that are more interesting and more in line, I think, that with what the music is going for. You know, like for example, even just generally about all the pizzas. A pizza is it's a very pianistic type of sound because you're only dealing with the initial part of the sound. You can't really control what happens after. So having a really clear idea of what you want on all the pizzas, the kind of tone color you want, and then taking that, you know, to all these marcato, you know, for example. All this stuff where you have the... Just kind of experimenting more with sounds that have less care for the whole of the note and more just really for the articulation, uh-huh. I think, and that will also help sort of with the balance because you know, I consider this piece to be one of the best written of all the sonatas in our repertoire in terms of balance because the piano writing is not actually that thick, and I think it's kind of actually almost it seems too simple in some ways. You know, when you look at it on the page, and I think that there's a risk also sometimes of trying to add too much in when there's actually not that much there. I mean, there's a lot there, but the texture is actually not that thick, right? So finding the transparency that's inherent in the piece, I think, is also a big part of it. Anyway, I've blabbed enough. Should we try the beginning? You know, in general, the I thought your tempo in the Allegro monotroppo was very good. Yeah, I'll just say that. And yeah, I don't play. You might want to consider, right, because you know this, anytime you change strings, you're immediately kind of killing the cantabile because the string has to stop resonating, the previous one that you were on. And also, you know, pertaining to the tempo, it's in two, right? I think you want to look for fewer and fewer impulses, as few impulses as possible. So for example, you know, the first two bars, right? But here in this bar, it's kind of, it's easy to think of the three impulses there, but if you get a and then find new impulses, like, just less frequently. And then the last thing I would say is that rhythmically, this kind of, it's always troubled me a little bit, but this, it's actually a really, really fast rhythm if you subdivide very accurately. And a lot of people, they play it kind of like a triplet, like an eighth even. So. Of course, it gets harder. I don't know how you would do it, but you know, you have to really dummy. Remember that more later. You know, it should be very springy, I think. Okay. It should be kind of humorously absurd, rhythmically. Yeah. Okay, you want to try the beginning one more time? Nice. that was very impressive, that shift. You might want to consider, so just a small thing about fingerings. I personally believe that you should have like two fingerings minimum for every passage, just because the fingering, having different fingerings really allows you to understand the what's going on in the music at a deeper level, because you don't become tied to a particular technical aspect that's dictating what the way that you experience it. So you might want to try, here you can do, if you have, you can get a really quick response. Of course you did that phenomenally, but if we were to be truly pianistic, you know, right, all in the same hand position, right? So anyway, you can try that. Like, of course you don't have to do it, and Rostropovich didn't do it, I don't think. I think he shifted. But anyway, that was much better. Yeah, keep it kind of flowing. The overall sense of pulse, it should not get too in four. All the accompanimental stuff in the left hand of the piano. So in general, when you have like fortissimo stuff, I would say that you should just want to go closer to the bridge. You have a fantastic cantabile at the bridge, but I thought that a lot of your like rougher stuff, I mean, it's great. You kind of have the issue of being too concerned with the beautiful tone color. So you know, it's against kind of your you probably like. But you know, I think that this, you know, you have to kind of rough it up a little.
Thank you.
here? Because all I would say is that I would definitely. Yeah, don't do it too well. No need. Yeah. Okay, and then here, this was great. But I think you still need a little more, because it sounds a little like Tchaikovsky, you know. And then don't give up also here. As the phrase goes on, persist in the articulation. Yeah, I mean, but that's fine. I love that mezzo forte, but then you just need to make the forte more. yeah, and all this stuff, I see this kind of more suddenly. It's kind of like it's a very flirtatious passage, I think. You know, the chromatic, it kind of reminds me of. Right, it has that same kind of feel. So I would, you know. And again, the cantabile, I think, is more just, he's telling you, like, play on the same string. You know, don't go to the D string and keep the vibrato up and sustain a little, you know. But I think, you know, again, it's sparse, so you kind of have to look a layer deeper and make a decision about what you want. And usually, whatever intuitively comes to you is probably correct, because I think the music is really intuitive music. Yeah, so just try from, sustain a little through, because it's, but it'll be 1%. Okay, sorry, since we're almost out of time, I'm just going to say one other thing about the next section, the Andantino. It was very, very beautiful and very emotional, and I actually really enjoyed it. You might want to consider taking it faster, though, and I'll tell you why I think so. Because when you get to... you know, it's funny with a lot of... I think with very good music, there's often a passage in the movement where there's just a tempo that's perfect for that passage. And it's like, you ask a 10 cellist, and they'll say like, oh yeah, that passage I played at this tempo because it's the only way it works. And I think that this is one of those ones where there's just a right tempo for the stroke. Sorry, I haven't figured out, but something like that. So, it's quite fast actually, it's a... Something like that, right? Or wait, am I doing it the whole time? Sorry, yeah, I'm doing W. Fiona Huang, who will be playing the Schumann Adagio and Allegro. Is that right?
Okay.
So I'll tell you something funny. Before we started, I heard you practicing the and when I heard you practicing that, I was like, oh yeah, that passage, because that's really hard. But I'll tell you something funny about that, which is that how old are you?
14.
Okay, yeah. So when I was 14, when I was your age, I really struggled with that passage. It was like, I still struggle with it, but I struggled with it both in the playing sense and in the mental sense. Because I was convinced that whenever I played the piece, like when I got there, I would screw it up, or like, you know, because a few times, you know, I went like, you know, the finger just like goes off the string, right? Because it's a tricky shift. And it was just really unfortunate, you know, because every time I played, I just lived with constant fear of missing that shift. And then I didn't play the piece for like, I don't know, 5-6 years. And then when I came back to it, I didn't fear it anymore. I still missed it, but I didn't fear it. I ended up fearing something else, which is the... So anyway, just to give you some motivation, one day, you know, your anxiety about that passage will pass, but anxiety about a different passage will creep up. So, such is the cycle, yeah? anyway. So, yeah, great. So, just a couple general things. One is that I wanted to talk for a second about legato, because it's something that I'm very, very interested in. So, you know, it occurred to me that, you know, it's often the case. I remember when I was your age, I was playing a D major scale for my teacher, Richard Aaron, and I started playing a D major scale, and you know, I went kind of, and he stopped me after a second. He was like, you know, you're doing portato on every single note. Like, you know, I was like, oh my gosh, I am. You know, and the way you can tell is the stick moves, right? And what's interesting is that doing portato is actually a much harder stroke than not doing it. Because think about it, the first thing we learn how to do on the cello is just play an open string. Twinkle, twinkle, twinkle. We're not playing, right, controlling all the, you know, it actually requires a lot of technique to like control the stick in that way. So when I work on legato personally, I like to think of it as just making it easier. You know, of course, it has other difficulties in terms of phrasing, but when you're just playing a simple scale like that, you can really keep the stick as if you were just playing. So therefore, one of my favorite ways to practice a lyrical thing like the adagio would be just actually practice on the open string. So like, let's say you start on an up, right? So the phrasing you want, I mean, it depends on the bowing, but you're probably gonna lead to the down bow, right? So you can really practice. And there you go. That's all you need to do with the bow. And then all the rest of the detail comes in the left hand. Right, so, yeah. In general, I noticed that your sostenuto was better on your down bows, and it was less good on your up bow. So I'll give you like a good example. In the middle section, the etwas ruhiger, when you have here, it was very good here, but then those three notes, it's very easy. It feels easier, right? But it's really, and also requires more specificity in the left hand, because the shifts need to be managed in a way that doesn't create too much messiness, right? So anyway, that was just a general thing. So you want to try the beginning and think about that, in the very, very beginning of the adagio. Oh. Good. Try one more time. Yeah, sorry, because it felt the tempo was a little. Thank you. it's overall really great. What I feel is missing is this part here from the G. You really want to feel that it's consistently singing because it sounds a little like there's a change in color on the F, but the change actually should come in the middle of the F, right? The F was much better, but the E natural now, I felt a little, it was a little too disconnected. If you can really keep singing through the whole thing. It's often a very big habit for a lot of string players, not only cellos, also violinists. When they change at the tip, they just give this as an example, but it speeds up a little bit. They feel compelled to use all the bow. But actually, I think that the way to have really legato string changes at the tip is to think about playing slower right before the change. So you slow down. Keep it singing all the way through the change. Yeah. And then lastly, here, the speed of the shift, because you can either shift at a fast speed or shift more, or again, capture a little bit at the top, all sorts of things. It's a very lyrical, lyrical moment. It's the first big shift. Anyway, okay, last time for the first 2 bars. Surprised how many people just kind of play that normally. I really felt that you were, playing the chamber music. Yeah, that was wonderful. The only thing is that the very end, this downbeat, I think it's very important that you, because it's easy to just kind of da, da, ya, da, da. But you really want to hear the da, da, ya, da, dee. How you have the polyphony between your note and the resolution. And then, of course, it makes the transition harder, but that's what the music needs. So yeah, really try to feel again the legato, and then all throughout this passage, you might want to consider changing the bowing because all this it can be very claustrophobic suddenly, So suddenly it's very tricky, but a few options. Yeah, you want to go from the E flat?
Thank you.
more legato. And then at the very end, feel that at the very end, you play, basically play chamber music with the rest, right? The rest is coming in, you're leaving it, but you have to pass it off to the rest. And then, that was beautiful that you did that second. Yeah, just right from that bar.
Thing is to do a diminuendo.
crescendo legato on an up hook. That's exactly what you have to do right there. So, yeah, you just work on that. And great, actually, I love the way that you interpret this, where that is kind of, it's, I know it's a really, really hard passage, especially with the thumb fingering. Keep it flowing though, because if you kind of feel the technicality, then you're gonna get stuck. So you're gonna something like that. Because again, you have all these terraces. You have to keep growing. The phrase doesn't end anywhere. I kind of want to just move a little bit to the Allegro because it's just a couple things to discuss. So in the Allegro, the big thing is that the articulation. I would have a little more similar to what we were talking about in Prokofiev, just it's kind of, again, you're imitating the horn sound, right? So, kind of really like a very resonant and rich and full. You want to be above the piano texture at all times. Yeah, just try that. Sorry to cut off the Adagio. Yeah, or it could be a little more off the string. It could be, or try it in context. Yeah.
Sorry.
Try it in context. Yeah, good. I think it's a little too close to the fingerboard. I would. Thank you. still very soft. It feels like piano to me, but I think it's fortissimo, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's fortissimo with a crescendo. And by the way, that also gets frottando. I think that really means that you should need to follow through on the story instead of just really and lead off to the piano. And so let's go on past the double bar just for a second. If you're two together, then you fail.
Yeah.
So. Let's see how anarchic you can be. Thank you. great. I think on the whole it's fantastic. You know, the big challenge with this piece is it's honestly just knowing the orchestra part. I remember the first time that I played it in studio class, I was like woefully unprepared. And it didn't happen, because I played the whole thing, but it didn't happen in the section you played, but there's like one long tutti kind of in the second half. And I got completely lost. I was like trying to count, and I got completely lost. And I just came in at a random time, and I was like 15 bars early. but yeah, anyway, it's hard. By the way, interesting anecdote about this piece. If you ever play it with an orchestra, there's a master class on YouTube. I don't know if you've seen it, with Kategorski teaching this.
Yes.
Yeah. So for those of you who don't know in the audience, there's something really interesting that he said, which is that he met Bloch when he was playing in Switzerland at some point. And Bloch was apparently really thrilled that he had used the music in the rehearsal, even though he was just using it for the reference of the rehearsal. He had actually memorized it. And Bloch said, like, oh, this piece, you know, I hate it when cellists play it from memory, because it's not a virtuoso piece. It's like, you know, you're a king and you have to be reading from a scroll. And I really like that, you know. So I play with the music, you know. It's nice just to have it there, because, you know, again, with the orchestra, it can be a little complex and things can definitely go wrong. I played it once, and at the very end, the bassoons completely miscounted, and it was just kind of a complete disaster. And like, they ended like a bar after me. so anything can happen, yeah.
Shall I do it again with the music?
No. But anyway, I mean, yeah, of course you should memorize it too, for your own knowledge. But it's just an interesting anecdote. Another interesting anecdote, this was like a long time ago, I can't even remember who it was, but you know, the cellos.org used to have like these interviews, and I can't remember who was being interviewed, but someone was being interviewed and they said like, oh, one of my most traumatic experiences was that one time I like showed up to a lesson with the Schelomo, and we spent the whole hour just working on the first note. It's a tough first note, yeah. But anyway, about the first note, yeah. So I've always felt that one bow is not enough. And you know, and that's just my opinion. I mean, I know Leonard Rose and yada, 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 they all do it with one bow, but it always feels too short to me. Because especially if you're taking a tempo, two, three, so it's like one, two, three. So if you do one bow, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, and you have the fermata now. And that just feels very constrained to me. So I prefer one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, and then I have enough room for the fermata. But anyway, that's just my opinion. You might want to consider it. But in any case, overall, the sound quality, especially for the beginning, as you know, like, you know, the orchestration is very kind of hum, you know, the percussion is like, it's very resonant. And I think overall the sound quality should be very, you don't want to approach the string too much like this. You want to approach the string kind of from beneath. But there's always this inherent, there's a ring, a resonance, the intonation, the cello's agreeing with you, basically. Do you want to just try that right there? Nice. It feels too short to me. That's all.
You can try it with two.
No, try it. Or try saving more. Yeah, I mean, either one. Nice. Yeah. Or, yeah, good. And actually, you can come in even later now, because you just more accent at the beginning, though, I think. It's kind of like the creation of the universe type of thing, you know. Of course, that's the other thing. I find it harder to do at the frog if you really, to really do the right accent, where you really, and then you can really let the sound go. And I would let the sound peak somewhere in the middle of the down bow, not at the actual change. Yeah. I'll try one more time. Keep it ringing too. Nice. Yeah. It was going a little too high and we lost the resonance.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that it's out of tune. Who cares if it's out of tune, but it's not ringing enough like that. One more time.
Sound.
really ideal, fantastic. Yeah, you want to take the cadenza?
Yeah. So if you kind of, you will not project. So you gotta, sorry, whoever it is, you want to really, that's where you kind of want to add a little bit of portato, I think. Yes.
In general, especially in the lower, I think it works just to, it's unnecessary, it's unfortunate that it has to be necessary. The next section was fantastic. Let's just skip very quickly, last thing. Here, you want to try from there? bum. First you have the fermatas in the middle. But when you finish the fermata, I would really... just play really in time because it's hard for the conductor to follow. And then when you get to the ad lib, of course, in here, this is very free. So think of it kind of as the tension between this rhythmic, intense music and then the free kind of textural, atmospheric music. Yeah, this was all great. Last thing I'll say, the endings of these ideas that kind of... spot would be that can be just a clear pickup. And then, the last thing I'll say is that here at before 12, I would do more animando because, again, you want the... You want it to not be grace note-y, very rhythmically precise. If you're too slow, then... just really get fast so you can really kind of... So you can play it in a tempo that feels very natural to you. The bulk of the accelerando will be the conductor's responsibility in the long notes, but 2, 3, but you can help by kind of... whatever it is, sorry. You can help by kind of pushing those forward. Fantastic. Really great.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, just on the whole, I mean, it's a really tricky piece, so I think you're doing it really fantastically. So I should be really proud of the work you've done. So yeah, I mean, a lot of this kind of stuff, it's just, I mean, what can you say? You're doing it really, really well. The only thing I would say about the first couple, like, pages is, have you thought about going faster? Because I think you could definitely do it. Unlike me. I mean, of course, yeah, you have to have the juice still quality, but also, you don't want it to sound too, I like to think, I think that Prokofiev is all about the larger impulses, you know, so the more you can search for just one, like one big idea, boom, persisting, yeah, I think, do you want to try? Just a hair faster? You don't have to go one far, but, you know, it's funny because this is the kind of piece where I think part of the idea is that you're kind of always teetering on the edge of collapse, and that's part of the excitement for both you and the audience. If you're too much in the controlled zone, then actually it doesn't become as interesting because, you know, it's kind of like watching the Olympics. You know, part of the reason why we enjoy watching Olympics is to see people fail, is to see people, like, you know, like seriously, you know, like if everyone like got perfect scores, what would be the fun in that, right? You want to have that margin of error and have that margin of risk that you're introducing. That's what keeps people interested.
Yeah. So
then just try a little bit, yeah. Okay. Go outside your comfort zone. Staging. And when you think about a large section like this, you really want to set the scene. Of course, the orchestra has a large responsibility in that in the four bars preceding. But once they've kind of established the mood, the lighting has changed on stage, it's your job to carry that throughout the entire section, throughout all the scene, all the drama that's happening between the characters. Yeah. It's kind of one idea. And then when people think back on it after they've heard the whole movie, we'll say, okay, yeah, that was that section, right? That was that scene. So do you want to just try from a... too slowly this way, you'll end up with a note that just, it's flat line, right? It has no life. And the thing about playing, you know, the passage, like, when you have a lot of moving notes, you don't need much vibrato, actually, to create the sense that something is still happening. But when you have these long notes, that's when the sound starts, you start to register that the sound has died, right? The sound has not, just has no life, it has no meaning, no direction. So what you should do is then think about how to give it that. Very, very important thing to be aware of is that in the long notes, you have a very wide vocabulary of possible forms, possible shapes, right? So you don't always want to, you know, swell to the middle. You don't always want to diminuendo from the beginning. You want to have, like, vocabulary, hundreds of different ways that you can handle one half note, right? So then you practice a lot that way. Then you realize, okay, maybe I've maxed out what I can do here, so if I play a little faster, then it'll actually feel more natural. And then the last step is that you add the vibrato. See where you actually really need the vibrato, because then something, of course, will still be missing, and what's missing is the vibrato, and then you have the whole picture, right? But think when they practice, they use vibrato as kind of a cover for what should be actually being accomplished in the right hand. Yeah. But anyway, so I thought that was great. I would just push yourself, you know, with a passage like this, push yourself to play it faster than you're comfortable with. I would say the same thing about Bach, you know, a lot of, because again, Bach, just like this, every end is a beginning. And if you can find a way to feel the much larger structure in a shorter amount of time by speeding up the tempo, sometimes in an absurd way, then you'll actually have a much more global view of what you want to do when you're playing at the correct tempo. Okay, just one thing I wanted to check. Just can you play from there? You just made a mistake, right? The note. Actually, that whole passage, that's another place where you can kind of, so it's like one large growth, right? So, you really feel that everything is leading up to that top and then coming down. And especially the second time, because it gets very technical. It's really tricky, but if you get it. Of course, there are different steps in that process, but if it's just one, maybe it's yeah. Okay, we're out of time. But yeah, really fantastic point. Really great.